Welcome, Elevate fam. What's up, guys?
What's up?
Welcome to church at home here at Elevate People. We are so excited that you are here. If you're tuning in at home, maybe you're tuning in on your couch or your bed, or maybe you were a little bit adventurous and you stepped onto the living room this morning, wherever you're at, right?
Yeah, maybe you're in the kitchen cooking breakfast or brewing coffee.
Or maybe you're going for a jog and you tuned in.
Maybe right? You're mowing your lawn.
Maybe you're doing yoga right now and you joined us.
Maybe you're on the moon.
Maybe you're on the moon. Hey, we are going to launch a moon campus, guys.
That's right.
Wherever you are tuning in today, we like to say this is family.
This is family.
So, hey, welcome to church at home. My name is Jesse.
And my name is Blake.
We like to call Blake One Take Blake. So welcome, One Take Blake.
Thank you.
We're your hosts today. We're going to make right. sure that you are cozy, that all your questions are answered. We're going to make sure that we're the guys that bring church to you today. We might even, we might even make you laugh a bit.
Speaking of laughing, I have a joke, Jesse. Do you want to hear it?
Actually, now's not the time for okay. jokes, but
I've been
why
practicing.
Not? We can edit it if it's not funny. Go for it. I'm ready.
Okay. Do you know why they don't let Jesus into jewelry stores anymore?
I don't know. Please tell me.
Because he'd be breaking every chain. Come on.
That was so good. That was so... You preaching today, bro.
Come on.
My gosh.
I'm only good for one, so that's it.
Exactly. So Again, my name is Jesse.
My name is Blake.
This is Blake. And welcome to Church at Home. You know, this is actually our first steps that we're taking as a church to transition back into church as we know it. So welcome, welcome aboard. Blake, please tell me, like, what do you miss the most about church, about seeing your friends, about coming in through the doors? Like, what do you miss the most?
You want to know what I miss the most, Jesse?
Please tell me.
This is it, right here.
Oh, hug? Yeah.
That awkwardness is what I miss about church. You don't get that anywhere else.
You don't get that anywhere else. We like to say, we have a policy here, no hugs, no bugs.
That's right. That's right.
Yes.
It's you want to show us? We made up one.
Yes. During this quarantine, we made up a 6-foot social distancing handshake.
That's right.
So we're going to show it to you live right here on.
Not exactly 6 feet, but you know, we'll make it
work.
Yeah,
oh yeah, here we go. So it's like,
boom.
Yeah. And then the foot, and then. Yes.
Yep. There you go.
Kobe.
That's right.
Actually, guys, we've never practiced that.
It's the first time.
Yeah, that we just threw that together.
It's all right.
I apologize that you saw that. let me go ahead and go forward. And what I'm here to do, tell you some announcements.
That's right.
So if this is your first time watching and you're wondering, man, who is Elevate People? How can I be a part of it? This is what you can do right now. Text the word HOME to the number below, 832-551-2008, and you have an opportunity to fill out our Connect card. This is simple information to let us know how we can serve you better. And after that, you will receive a text with a link on there that you can actually join our online Connect class. What that is, it's a Facebook page where you can watch a video from Pastor Brandon as he shares the vision, the mission, really the heart of Elevate and how you can be a part. So do that right now or right after service.
Yeah, and do you know if you share this post right now, Elevate donates $2 to local missions. That's right.
So
$2.
You're telling me if I share this post right now.
Every share.
$2 goes to.
Every single share goes $2.
Guys, missions. I'm actually going to do that right now.
Do it right now.
Maybe after this, right? So, you know, here at Elevate, we believe that generosity is a privilege. We love to give. The easiest way that you can give right now, there is a QR code right underneath here. Scan it, and it will shoot you right to our giving page. That's the easiest way that you can do it. Or you can text the amount to 84321. Also, we have we love to serve our city. And actually, when the pandemic hit, the church rose up and we took care of the community the best way we know how. Hey, Blake, guess how many families we served during this pandemic?
1,433.
Wow, that was kind of precise.
It was very
actually
accurate. We also gave out over 15,000 meals.
Wow, that is amazing. That's impressive.
Yeah.
And if you want to be a part of loving your city, the best way to do that is go online to elevatepeople.tv/outreach and figure out ways how you can go out and love on your city. We are still hope on demand. Hey, guys, we are getting closer. We're about 10 seconds away from starting service. This is what I want you to do. Grab your Bible, stretch out your praise muscles, and let's bring God's presence right to where you are.
Just of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Sing, I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Sing it out. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that I can't do. This battle mounts to death. Sing out, yeah. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I can't do. There's nothing that I can't do. There's not a prison wall you can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I can't do. You make a way. You always make a way when I'm going. Hey, you're a miracle worker. Hey, there's nothing you can do, God. All things are possible. All things are possible, yeah. Hey, there's nothing that a God can do. There's nothing that a God can do.
Come on, somebody who's glad to be in church today. Come on, make some noise. All my friends in the building, everybody watching online, come on. Nothing that our God can't do. Welcome to Church at Home. Yes. Who's glad to be in church? Come on in, man. This
welcome,
worship
welcome.
Team just absolutely killing it. We're so glad that you guys are here. Let me tell you now, you picked the best decision of your week, and that's to hang out with us in church today. I'm here. My name is Brandon. This is my amazing wife, Kristen. And we have the honor to be the lead pastors here at Elevate. And we thank you for inviting us into your home, wherever you are. I love the moon campus that our pre-show kind of gave us a little bit. And wherever you're watching from, man, we're glad that you're tuning in here today. We want to encourage you. There's some information on the screen right now. You can actually text the word home. We have a value here at Elevate. We love to say that this is family.
Yeah.
Come on, how many believe in a family atmosphere in church?
Yes.
Amen. We believe in family and we want to do life together. Life is boring alone. And so we would love to connect with you. If you've never filled out a connect card, man, please do that by texting the word home to the number on your screen. It'll shoot you a link to fill that out. And then if you want to know more, we have what we call a connect class, where you're going to learn a little bit more about the heart and soul of our church. And you don't have to be here in Houston to be a part of our church. Man, yeah. We have an online family, and we would love to connect with you even further. And speaking of that, man, one way to connect is we love to give.
Absolutely.
And one way we can do that is right now, if you haven't already, if you heard in the pre-show, if you share this right now, for every share, we're giving $2 to local missions to help families in need.
Yes.
In our city. Come on.
Yeah, so let's celebrate.
By just sharing, it's an act of generosity, and we love to give. We love to give.
So we have three ways to give here at Elevate. You can go to our website, elevatepeople.tv, and give that way. You can text the word give to the number on the screen, or there's a brand new way with our QR code. You can just pull out your phones, put your phones in camera mode, just like that, and a link will pop up. It will take you straight to the place where you can give. When we give, we are aligning our hearts with God. We're building His kingdom. And yeah. While we're doing that, He pours out His blessings on
That's
us.
Right.
So
Come
I encourage
on.
You guys to give today. Also, just like he said, we can't do this alone. So if you're struggling, if you're having a hard time, please text the word prayer to the number on the screen. We're going to have a team member reach out to you. You might not recognize the number, but answer the phone, share with them what's going on, and they're going to stand with you and agree with you. I do that. I have friends that I reach out to that help me when I'm having a hard time or a bad day. So don't do this alone, you guys. Reach out and text prayer.
We're super excited. excited about that. It's new with our online services, but we got live prayer happening right now. Yeah. So make sure you text that information. We're going to go into one more worship song here today as we continue. But I want to read this scripture and just pray it over your lives. And we're going to pray and then go into one more song. It says in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, it says this, "But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all more gladly about my weakness, so that," I love this, here's the key, "so that Christ's power may rest on me." And here's what I believe. Here's what I know about the power of God. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what you tuned in today, what you're going through, what my friends in the room are going through. Maybe it's been a good week. Maybe it's been a bad week. Maybe right now you're just holding on to hope. You don't know what you're going to do in life. Here's what I know. The Bible says that his power is going to rest on you today. Yeah. That's what I believe. Yeah. And the power of God is not limited by these cameras. You can go right through the lens of this camera to wherever you are right now. And we're just going to believe God together as we worship. Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
That the peace of God is going to rest in your household right now. The peace of God is going to rest in your marriage and your family. There's going to be joy again that happens after today. How many of you just believe that today is going to be a day where God is going to rest on our need, and we're going to believe for even greater things are going to come. Amen. Come on, let's pray. Father, we love you today. We thank you for your worship. We thank you for the word that is going to be brought. Every person that is watching right now, God, no matter what they're facing, whatever it is that they're believing for, in Jesus' name, we declare that it is going to happen together in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Let's continue to worship.
I'm spoken and I'm stripes I am healed. With one touch I am made whole. You have spoken and I know that it is so. In the storm you are peace and your love.
Wherever you are right now, I mean, I feel the presence of God right where I am, and I know you do too, watching. And I want to encourage you, wherever you are, just kind of like, just turn your hands a little bit up to the Lord. And I don't know why I feel led to do this, but I want you to just kind of just sing softly, but I just feel led. I'm going to ask us in the room. I'm just going to kind of take a moment real quick. I just feel like we're supposed to get on our knees and just invite the presence of God into your home and into your situation. We're going to do it here together. Just as a sign of just giving it all to Jesus. Can we just sing that one more time, Shannon? Just sometimes it's good for us to sing, but then there's sometimes it's good to allow the worship to sing over us. And I'm asking you to turn up the volume in your home, and I really believe as we sing this right now, I believe the presence of God is going to fill your household, your car, your office, wherever you're watching from right now. Just give a moment to let Jesus move. Sometimes no words need to be said, just worship and the reverence of God. Just start praying to Him all your needs and everything you need. And sing it one more time.
In the storm, you are peace.
Thank you, Jesus.
And your love won't let me go. You have spoken, and I know that it is so.
Sing it one more time.
In the storm, you are peace, and your love won't let me go. You have spoken, and I know that it is so.
You have spoken.
You have spoken.
We know that it is so. Father, we thank you for this moment of worship. Thank you for the presence of God. Father, you spoke it. You said it is so. Whatever it is we're believing for, and believing God for, you said good things come from those who love the Lord. And we love you, Jesus. We thank you. Give this moment of worship to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, if we're in the room, just come on, let's just give God the praise he deserves. Everybody watching, come on. Thank you, team. Just hang out with me for a second, man. Come on. Anybody just feel God's presence right there? Like, I know about you, but I tell you, I just love the presence of God and how let's just give it up for that worship. Come on, just show some love to the amazing worship team. Absolutely killing it. Come on, make some noise. Give me some emojis, something, some likes, wherever you are. And I pray that moment, honestly, like I'm kind of at a moment where I almost don't want to preach. I know I got to. I feel like God has actually given me a word based off that song. And I should have looked, but I didn't even know we were singing that song. And it's just right in line with what God has in my heart. But I just pray that maybe for some of you, because you haven't been in the atmosphere of church, I really feel like maybe that moment just kind of like gave you kind of a sneak peek back into what it feels like to be in the presence of God. And I know we felt it here in the room. And I pray you felt it. You felt it as well. And so I'm fired up about what God has on my heart today. And I don't know, did anybody come ready for the word in here? Come on, anybody? I got some friends. I hope you came ready for God's word. I want to encourage you to open your Bibles with me, and I'm going to pray here in just a second. But open your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. We're going to continue a series. We kicked it off last week called Rise. Everybody shout Rise. Come on, Rise. And I'm excited about that, and I'm going to continue it here today and continue to believe that this is still a year that God can do everything that you're believing for. If God spoke it, it is so. That's what we just sang over our lives. And I believe that. Do you believe that today, church? Come on, are you with me? You believe that today. And I believe God is going to do something great. And it's been mentioned a couple of times before, but I want to mention it again. If you have not, man, a simple act of generosity is you can just share this post right now. Share it right now. For every share, we're going to give $2 to local missions. But more than that, too, just if you're feeling God's presence right now in your life, why not share it with a friend? So share it on whatever platform you're doing, and we're excited about what God is going to do today. Here's the title of my message if you want to take notes. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to go. Come on, we believe in being note takers and Bible bringers, right? Come on, all right? So on your phone, pull it out. Wherever you are, YouVersion, sitting at home, grab your Bible. And I'm going to read out of the NIV translation in 2 Kings chapter 4. But I want to preach from this topic. When failure comes knocking, you could say when disappointment comes knocking, when you feel like all hope is done comes knocking. But I know this, anytime there's a knock, that means there's an opportunity. So when failure comes knocking, I believe God's going to do something great today. Can I get a good amen in the house? All right, friends in the house here, y'all going to help me preach today? Come on, all right? Just like we say on Sundays, you shout amen loud, I'll preach quick. Let's go. We all going to get hungry, and we're going to go to Luby's. Let's go. Come on. You can wear a mask in Luby's. Luby's ain't shutting down. We're going to serve. Come on, some fish and coleslaw. It's going to be good. We have some fun. But God, we thank you for today. Thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. Everybody watching right now, just what a crazy time to live in. But even in the middle of that, Father, of how the uncertainty of every day, we can still count on a certain God. We can count on the certainty of you, Lord, that you'll never leave us, you'll never forsake us. And Father, as we communicate your word today, Father. I pray that it pierces our hearts, it speaks to everybody's situation, wherever they are. And Father, wherever we're feeling, maybe we feel like we're in a moment of failure. We messed up. We made some mistakes. Maybe we feel like hope is gone. Maybe we feel like, how in the world is it, am I going to make it? Things are worse than what they were 3 days ago, or especially the beginning of the year. God, what am I going to do? Father, I pray you speak to our hearts today through your word, and we're going to leave here better than we came in. And we give it all to you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, come on, amen, amen, amen. Come on, give it up for God one more time. Hit me some like, blow it up in the comments, engage. Give me a little amen in the house. 2 Kings chapter 4. You good, my man. Even though you sound really, really good behind me. Way better. Preach way better. But we won't be long. We hang out. Give it up for my man. He's absolutely killing it on the keys. I'm going to read this. I'm actually going to read a little bit more text than the norm, okay? I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to kind of walk through a story with you guys here today. And that's what I feel led to do. I have a few points right at the end that I'm going to give you. But leading up to that, I just kind of feel led. Sometimes I love to bounce around the scripture. But then there's sometimes I love to take a scripture and just kind of walk it out together and pull out just how God is speaking to me as I was reading this. That sound all right, everybody? All right, I think that's what I want to do. So I'm going to read a lot of scripture. Hang out with me. It might skip around some, but then we'll dive into it. This is an amazing story in the Bible. An amazing story with, to give you the quick context of it all, is we have a story with a woman. The Bible says she's a well-to-do woman, meaning she's blessed. She's got a lot of resources. She's educated. She's got a lot going on for her, but yet she had a dream in her heart to have a son. But then all of a sudden that wasn't going to happen, so she gave up on that dream. And then a prophet by the name of Elisha showed up, spoke that dream back into her heart, see if it would rise again. She gave birth to her son, and that what she thought was gone, God said, no, 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 it's still alive. Come on, right? And then later on in life, the very prayer that was answered was taken away, and the son died. But yet it came back again one more time. How many thankful we serve a God of the one more time? Come on, are you with me? Amen. So that's kind of the synopsis of the whole passage. But I want to read it to you in detail. I'm going to read it a little bit fast, but here we go. So it says, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8. If you're there in the house, somebody shout, yeah. Come on, all right? Come on, we back in church, baby. Let's go. Verse 8. One day Elisha went to Shunem, and a well-to-do woman was there, who urged him to stay for a meal. So whenever he came by, he stopped there to eat. She said to her husband, I know that this man who often comes our way is a holy man of God. Let's make a small room on the roof, put it in the bed and a table, a chair, a lamp, and a hot tub. Call him somebody. That's just my version. Then he can stay here whenever. In other words, this is the original Airbnb. Come on, somebody, all right? It's going to make it happen up there. Verse 11. One day when Elisha came, he went up to his room and he lay down there. He said to the servant, Gehazi, his servant there, he said, call the woman. So he called her, and she stood, and she came, and she stood before him. Elisha calls her up twice in the story. So this is the first time she comes up, and she stands at the very doorway of the place to where a dream that she had in her heart. This was going to be her son's room, and that dream is gone, and all of a sudden she changed it into something different than what first God spoken to her because she gave up. So this is the first time. Then it goes into, say, in verse, So he called her, and it's 13. Elisha said to her, you have gone to all this trouble for us. Now, what can be done for you? Can we speak on your behalf? How can we pray with you? How can we believe for you is what he's asking. She replied, I have a home among my own people. Another translation says, she mentions like, I'm good. Everybody shout, I'm good. Anybody met somebody like that? Like, yeah, I'm good. But you know you ain't good? Like we've all said that as well. Right? Everybody shout, I'm good. I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. Yeah. No, you ain't. You hurting. We're going to come back to that. Then it goes on to say, she replied, I'm good. Verse 14, what can be done for her? Elijah's like, she lied. Like, I want to help this lady. There's obviously, she ain't good. So he asks his servant to investigate a little bit. And he goes on to say, she has no son. Her husband is old. Then Elisha said, call her again. So he called her again, and she came back and stood in the doorway. And notice Elijah didn't ask her any more questions. He just went in to speak promise and hope and direction in her life. And Elijah said, "Will you, at this time, you will hold a son in your arms by next year." And then she said, "No, my Lord, no, no, please, man of God, don't mislead your servant. Don't get my hopes up like that. Don't, man, I went ahead and just kind of gave up on that dream. Like, don't get my hopes up, bro. I'm letting you stay here in a good rate with my Airbnb. Like, don't, no. I don't want to hear it. I let it go. It was too painful." Then guess what? By this time next year, in verse 17, she had a son, just like the Lord said. The child grew, and one day he went out to his father, and he was with the reapers. He was harvesting crops. And he said to his father, my head, the son shouted. And his father and the servant, he says, carry him to his mother. After the servant had lifted him and carried him to his mother, the boy sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. The very answered prayer was now taken away from her. Then it goes on to say in verse 21, she went up and she laid on the bed. This is very important. She went up and she laid him on the bed of the man of God, then shut the door and went out. She went and put him back into the room. Verse 22, she called her husband and said, please send me one of the servants and a donkey so I can go quickly to the man of God. And then her husband said something she didn't expect. Why go today? It's not the new moon. It's not the Sabbath. That's right, she said. That's all right, she said. She saddled a donkey. She basically just ignored it. Said, forget you. I'm going. Said, who's going to roll with me? And a servant rolled with her. And she said, lean on. Don't slow down unless I tell you. So she set out to see the man of God. She set out to meet with the Lord is what she did. So get down to verse 28. Did I ask for a son, my Lord? Notice her aggression, which she had every right to be upset. Man, God, like you got my hopes up again to believe, and then all of a sudden you take away what I chose to believe in again? And she just goes off. And I don't know about you, but if you haven't been told lately, it's okay to go off on the Lord. He's a big God. He can take it. You know that, right? Anybody ever just gone off on God? If you haven't, like, here's your permission. Go do it. You'll feel so much better about yourself, and you'll realize, oh, you still there? Yeah, bro, I'm here. He's a good God. He's a good God. Come on. Somebody just shouted, thank you, Lord, really big in here. But are you with me? Everybody still with me? Say yeah. And he says, don't keep my hopes up. Verse 28, skip down to verse 30. But the child's mother said, and this is important, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. I will not leave you. When failure comes knocking. You know, I love this story in the Bible. And I actually want to speak to two different types of seasons that we all go through. Maybe you might find yourself in one of these seasons right now. You may, if not, you will encounter it someday. And I like this story because, honestly, I believe this story could have had its entire own book in the Bible. But for some reason, the Lord and the Holy Spirit said, we're going to condense this down to just a few scriptures. Because there's multiple seasons. There's years apart within the scripture, within literally two scriptures. I mean, multiple seasons that even the season I think about when she had a dream in her heart to be a mother. And to believe in God for her son. And then all of a sudden there came a time and age where she just gave up on that dream. Maybe it's not meant for me. Maybe God made a mistake saying that to me. She gave it up. And then all of a sudden we see the season where a man by the name of Elisha rolls up. She's doing a good deed. The very room that was going to be her son's, she let it die. So she said, apparently it's not you, Lord. So she changed the identity of what God originally intended her dream to be. Are y'all following me? Then it goes on to say Elijah spoke into her life, and then she believed again when she didn't want to. And then God allowed, and I don't understand this, we'll talk about it, allowed an answered prayer to be taken away. And that here she finds herself again still trying to believe. Two seasons that I think we all find ourselves in. And I'm going to kind of walk this out with you. I believe that there are seasons to where there's opportunities we face to believe. There's going to come moments in life where fear, failure, disappointment, mistakes is going to come knocking. And do you realize it as an opportunity, or are you going to let it take you out? There's seasons we go, and I think we're actually in a season of opportunity right now. Through this pandemic and everything that is going on in our lives, we're in a season where, like, I believe opportunity is knocking like never before to believe that we serve a God who is not bound by boundaries or resources or anything. He's still a God who can do everything that is in your heart, pandemic or no pandemic. I believe we're in a season where we face opportunity to believe and to grow our faith. And I believe there's also seasons when we have answered prayers taken away. And it's not very easy to live with. The door of opportunity. Sometimes I believe, come on, anybody ever like have opportunity in front of you and you let a little bit of fear grip you a little bit? Am I right? And we're like, I need A through Z to line up. I need every dot dotted, every I dotted, every T crossed. I need a homeboy in a purple button-up three-piece suit rocking some Gators to walk up to me at 7:52 p.m. on a Thursday. Then I'll know it's you, Lord. Like, we put so many details on God when he doesn't put details on us. And there's a door of opportunity, and sometimes, opportunity's greatest moment comes when God resurrects something that we let die. Sometimes God's greatest opportunity, your greatest opportunity to succeed, to go to the next level, to see that breakthrough in your life, sometimes your greatest opportunity comes when what you are ready to give up on, God says, no, I'm ready for it to rise up in your heart again. There's something that we've tried to forget, that God is saying, no, I sent you to this world to do that. I sent you to this world to be a mom. I sent you to this world to be a dad, to launch that business, to launch that dream, to believe God, to be generous. And everything that's in your heart's not a mistake. So what you think is dead, there's going to be moments to where that's the perfect time for me to come in and say, no, we got to get you to rise up again and believe again. Are y'all with me? Can I get a yeah? It's almost like you hoped it died because it was too painful and it became too much. Have we all been there? And because it became so painful, you hoped that, well, maybe God, this was not for me. Maybe it wasn't for me. And I don't know about you, but I've lived life long enough. If you haven't, you will. But I've lived life long enough where I'm going to go through seasons where my situation gets worse and my faith has an opportunity to thrive like never before. And what am I gonna do in those moments? Am I gonna rise up and change my situation, or am I gonna let my situation change me? What am I gonna do when failure comes knocking? Am I gonna let it take me out, or am I gonna rise up with my faith like never before and still believe that I serve a God who is above and not beneath, a God who is ahead and not behind, a God who is with me and whose grace and love that goes from north, south, east, and the west. He loves me right where I am to help me get to where I'm going. So when failure comes knocking, what am I gonna do? Elisha, he calls her up the first time and he offers her an opportunity to believe again. He says, what are you believing for? How can we believe with you? What do you need? And she's like, I'm good. Yo, I'm good. Bruh. Anytime your friend leads with bro, you know they lying. Come on, am I right? Like, bro, I'm good. No, you ain't good. The Bible says that she was a well-to-do woman. And a well-to-do woman means that she was educated. She was highly resourced. In other words, she had the appearance that life was good. Why do I think the Bible described her in this way? It's because the Bible wanted us to know that because she was a well-to-do woman and was highly resourced, if she could not have a child, you know, she had certain privileges that not everybody had. Not everybody can go and see the best doctors. Not everybody can jump on a plane and travel around the world and see some up-and-coming new study. She had the opportunity which to use every resource that man offered. And when she got to the place to where man can't offer her anything, it led her to a place of desperation, and it was easier to forget than to keep believing. Come on, have we been there? if we get honest. Like, what do I do, Lord? And here's what I love about Elisha saw straight through the fake, I'm good. Come on, how many, that's a good friend. I don't want a friend when I say I'm good, just kind of lets me go along my way. I need a friend who recognizes my fake, I'm good, and calls me out on my mess. Oh, bro, you ain't good, homie. That's why we love to say here at Elevate, this is family. Because if we family, we don't want you to come all together, right? We want you to come as you are, broken, busted, disgusted, like in pieces. Like we just love you wherever you are. It's not like we're gonna walk in the floor and like call you out, like you hurting. We don't roll that way. You're going to hell. Turn to burn now. It's not how we roll, but if we really are family. And I thought to myself, am I a good friend? Am I a good leader? To where when somebody rolls up into my life, to where I'm able to call out the fake, I'm good. Because I love them enough. I think that there's people in your life right now, and it might be you, to where you're hoping they don't acknowledge your fake, I'm good. And you want to keep on hurting. And I think there's people in your life right now, maybe watching right now, you're hoping that somebody, maybe they'll just see that I'm faking it. And because of my laziness, I don't ask again, are you sure you're good? Am I a good enough friend? Am I bold enough? Do I have the awareness to know that a fake I'm good ain't cutting it, and they're dying on the inside and they've allowed a dream to settle that it's not supposed to settle? Come on, am I talking to anybody? Are you with me? Like, it goes into this, and all of a sudden, here comes a second time. Elisha calls her up a second time. Isn't this just like God? God will do this all the time. God is amazing. Twice now, he brought her up to the very doorstep to where she had to let and choose her dream to die. God will always bring you to the doorstep of your last moment and memory of failure to remind you what you thought was lost is not lost. He'll speak purpose in the middle of your failure. I feel like I'm preaching good. I don't know anybody like I'm preaching to me. I don't know if anybody else, like, are you with me? It's like in the moment of failure, you think God is gone. No, that's when he's the loudest. This is why we got to be in church. This is why we got to be in God's presence. Because when failure comes knocking, God comes shouting. He called her up the second time. And I love this. She actually gets mad at him. Real mad at him. Don't you get my hopes up? As it says in verse 15 and 16. She stood in the doorway. Don't you get my hopes up, man of God? No. I don't want to believe in that again. I just settled that in my life. Don't try to raise my faith again, and I want to believe. She just got so mad at him. But here's what I love about Elisha. Elisha, he knew that if he let her stay in her I'm good faith state of mind, she would never find her breakthrough. And I wonder what my I'm good faith level is. That's what I love about Elisha. He didn't let it go by. He's like, no. You need to recognize that your I'm good faith, like, it ain't cutting it. Like, I'm calling your bluff. Like, I need you to realize that if you don't realize that the dream inside of you is still real and still needed, then you're not going to realize when failure or disappointment comes knocking, it's still your greatest opportunity to believe God for good things in your life. Are you following me? She's getting mad at him. Y'all ever got mad at somebody that kept asking you, you good? Let me tell you right now, and I guarantee I'd be 99.9% right all the time. Those of you who are getting frustrated with people asking you that I'm good, it's probably because you ain't good. Or else they wouldn't be asking. Stop getting mad at people who be like checking on your I'm good fake faith. Instead, maybe you just should be thankful that God has placed certain people with vision and eyes for your life to speak the good inside of you and to say you can do great things. Your marriage can thrive again. Your family can thrive again. Your finances can happen again. What you thought is dead ain't dead. Don't forget what God has spoken over your life. Come on. Are you with me? Like, we got to believe again. I need people in my life. I love how Elisha looked past her objection and rejection of God. I just wonder how many of us, and he spoke something greater in her life. I just wonder how many internal decisions I make that immediately dismiss God in my equation. My natural response is, no, I thought it was. My natural response is, man, I tried for so long. I just wonder if there are relationships, friendships, jobs, financial decisions, dreams, marriages, things that are in your heart, and you know what that is, that it feels like it's easier to quit than to keep believing. And I don't know why, I just felt, my wife knows, I was studying all this week, just trying to figure out, Lord, where do you want this to land? And yesterday I felt like the Lord wanted me to teach this. And it's basically just to stir your heart to not quit, to stir your heart to keep believing. And you might be in a season where I'm speaking to you right now about that. But then there's the other season of this story that I love. It's the one to where I'll kind of close out with 3 points here today to bring some application to what we're believing for. But the next season, the lady, we know the story. If you go on to read, she, even though she doubted it, she didn't want to believe, God still spoke it. Thank God Elisha looked past the fake, I'm good faith. And he said, no. God has said it's going to happen. She gave birth to a son. And then all of a sudden, the son one day, his head is hurting. And we enter into the next season of this lady's life that I think we can learn from. This season is not fun to preach about as a pastor. This season is when God answered her prayer with having a son and then later took that answered prayer away. This is where people have a hard time having faith in God. Asking the questions, what kind of God gives a promise to a person and then someday lets that promise die? What kind of God? Why would God let something so dark happen to someone who didn't ask to be put in this position in the first place? God, can I tell you, I don't understand all of God's decisions. But the purpose of faith is I trust them all. And even though I can't control it, even though there's maybe some dreams that I feel like are dead, maybe there's some things that I need to believe in God again. The one thing I can rest on is I know that my God loves me. He may give me things, he may take it away, but I know he's in the middle of it. And as long as I stay centered in a relationship with Jesus, I know sooner or later the sun's going to come up. Come on, are you with me? Joy is going to rise again. Hope is going to rise again. But something amazing happens in the story. Come on, you got to hear this, friends. Something incredible happens in this story. The lady, when her son dies, she doesn't fall back. Come on, hear me. She doesn't fall back into her fake, I'm good faith, which many of us do. When we make a mistake, when we feel like God takes something away, why would you take this person from me? Why would you allow this thing to happen? I gave you my best, God. Why are you blessing everybody else but me? And all of a sudden, there comes a moment that where when one thing happens, one text, one email, one moment, somebody says something to you, a failure happens, you make a mistake, whatever it is, we usually fall back into the I'm good fake faith. But this lady does just the opposite. This is when you begin to see maturity in faith. So I don't fall back to I'm good in my old habits, but I step up to continue to believe that when failure comes knocking and disappointment comes knocking, I still serve a God. It's my greatest moment to believe God for a miracle than ever before. Come on, are you with me, guys? Come on. All right, let me give you these 3 quick things that we can learn from her today on how even if all hell breaks loose, you wake up tomorrow and something happens. If you stay grounded into these 3 things, I believe you can face anything that this world may throw at you. Come on, are y'all with me? Y'all want to hear that today? Number one is this. Notice what she did. The response this time. She didn't fall back. She stepped ahead. Number one is this. If you want to take notes, it's on your screen. I know it's simple, but it's so needed. She placed it back in God's hands. Y'all have heard that 1,000 times in church. But even if I've heard it 1,000 times, maybe I've implemented it twice if we get real. Verse 21 says this, she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God. Then she shut the door and she went out. This time it was different. This well-to-do woman who had all the resources, last time she tried to do it on her own. This time she learned different. She says, this time from the beginning, I'm going to put it in God's hands. God is now my first response and not my last resort. I'm going to do it different this time. If God takes something away from me tomorrow, I'm going to do it different this time. I'm not going to fall back into my fake, weak faith. I'm good. No, I'm going to rise up and I'm going to put it back into God's hands. In other words, I want you to get this. She took it back to the place where God first spoke the promise in her life. And that's the key, friends. Is you gotta go back to the place to remember when God said this. Maybe it's a place, maybe it's a person in your life to remind you, hey, like, don't forget what God said. That dream he gave you isn't a mistake. What you're believing for isn't a mistake. You didn't mess up marrying that person. You didn't mess up making that investment. Maybe things in life is hard a little bit. Maybe you have some loss, but guess what? We still serve a God who is a winner, and you're going to win a whole lot more at the end of the race. It's not about one lap. It's about finishing the race that God set out before you. But you got to remember what God said. But here's the thing that blew me away, that challenged me, is if you know, she knew where she was supposed to go. She had a place to go. My question to you is, do you have a place? And I'm willing to bet, and I had a child, I have a few friends I can text, I have a screenshot on my phone from Mama Janice that we talked about last week. Every day I read it over my life. I have some places and people that I can go to that when I get weak or something goes down, I can go back to the place of, you remember when? And if you don't have that place or you don't have that person, no wonder you're falling back into the, I'm good. Instead of pressing on to believing. Come on, am I talking to anybody? Come on, are y'all with me? Let me know you're with me watching online, family. This step isn't easy, but it's absolutely necessary. Because when it's in God's hands, it's out of yours. And I know that sounds so simple, but you've got to fight for peace for that. Because that ain't easy for this boy. I want to do it myself. Second point is this, and the team's going to start to come and join me. It made me sound a whole lot better playing them keys in the background. Come on, bro. Second point is this. You got to get this. She had to ask herself, who's riding with me? Who's my shake and bake? Who's my ride or die? Who's riding with me? Verse 22 and 24. She went to her husband and asked for help. And he's like, what? You want to go today? He said, it's not even the new moon or the Sabbath. In other words, the weather's not right, or the circumstance isn't perfect. And like, what? Why? Like, why don't you just accept that this is over? But she didn't accept that. And this is what I love about the woman. She didn't let nobody pull her back into the I'm good, weak faith. No person, no thing, no family member. She didn't let nobody pull her back. And she's like, man, I need to find somebody who's going to roll with me. And she found a servant. She said, you better go. You don't stop until I tell you to stop. Who's riding with you? I want you to hear me. Which friends are bringing you purpose in your life right now, and which friends are toxic? Is the relationship you're dating right now, is it bringing purpose to your life, or is it toxic? The season that you're in, can I tell you, sometimes friends and family, y'all hear me today, friends and family sometimes don't know how to change seasons with you. God is calling you here. He's asking you to believe this, and they don't get it. Why would you believe for this? Just accept that it's over. No! I need to know, you rolling with me or not? You gonna believe with me or not? You gotta be okay sometimes, like, your friends, sometimes you have to ask yourself, are the friends in this season supposed to go with you to the next season? And if you let people hold you back, you won't step into the new that God has for you. In other words, I don't know about y'all, but I ain't got time to always be answering why. Come on, anybody here with that? I ain't got time when I say, hey, God has dropped this in my heart. Why? Why you want to do it? I ain't got time for why no more. I just need you to trust that Jesus on the inside of me, trust that I hear from the Lord, and I need you to know, are you with me? You going to help me build a church? You going to help me launch this dream? You going to help me launch this business? Are you going to believe with me or not that this marriage can work, that there can be healing in my body? No matter what the doctors say, cancer can be no more in my life. I can't get off this. I don't care if I got high last night. Do you believe or not that today can be my day of deliverance? Who's with me? Who's riding with you? Who's riding with you is every bit as important. Who is where you're going? She understood that. And here's the last thing, and we're going to pray and sing one more song. Man. There's always one more miracle. There's always one more miracle. Verse 30. The child's mother said, as surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you. Think about the faith of that statement. Before she gave up, this time, no matter what, God, I'm never leaving you. No matter what, I still trust you. No matter what, I still believe that one more miracle can happen in my life. There's still hope. And I'm telling you, some of you need to hear that today. There's still more for one more miracle. Don't let it die. It's not over. Your marriage, you got this. Your joy can come again. Yeah, during this quarantine, you're dealing with mental health, and we all are. We're all dealing with it. Like, depression is hit again. You're back popping pills, and you haven't done that in 5 years. I'm talking to somebody. I don't know who I'm talking to right now. I just feel that heavy in my heart. You're like back, but God is reminding you today there's still hope for one more miracle. He wants to touch your life. He wants to be there for you. What you thought was failure, I'm telling you, can be your greatest victory still. What you thought was your greatest loss can still become your strongest win. And here's what I want you to get. When failure, disappointment comes knocking, here's the beauty of it. It reminds you of the gift within you. Oh man, I used to hate failure, but now I'm thankful for it. I used to hate loss, but now I'm thankful for it. Because it reminds me of the gift within me, that my God doesn't love me based on what I do, but my God loves me based on who I am. And there's always hope to believe one more time. And so I want to encourage you, wherever you are, if you're in a moment right now, I don't know what season you're in. Maybe there's some things on the inside of you that if you've let it go, but God is saying, I'm ready for that to rise up in your heart again. Or maybe you're at a place saying, this time, I'm going to do it different. I'm going to put it in God's hands. I'm going to find out who's with me. They bring a purpose to my life, or they toxic. And no matter what, Jesus, I trust you. With every head bowed and eye closed in here, and everybody watching, all this happens and can only happen because of a relationship with Jesus. And I don't know where you are right now. I don't know where you're watching from. I don't know what you're facing. But there's information on the screen right now, and our team is ready to pray with you and be there for you. You can text the word Jesus to the number on the screen. You can even just type Jesus in the comments to let us know I'm talking to you. But every week we say here at Elevate that Jesus didn't die to be a part of your top three. He died to be number one in your life. And maybe things aren't as strong as they used to be. But let's change that. Here's what I know. No matter what you're facing, it always gets better with Jesus. And if you ain't tried it before, what does it hurt to try? Give him everything. Change your life. Change the habits. And I promise you, you won't regret it. So if you need Jesus today, I want to pray this simple prayer with you. It's real simple. Everybody in the room, say it with me. Let's say it loud together with our family watching online. Say, Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Jesus, thank you for shedding your blood for me. Wash my sins clean. Make me new and make me whole. From this day forward, Jesus, I give you my life and I give you my everything in Jesus' name. Let me just pray over everybody else here. If you pray that prayer, we're so excited for you. The Bible says when one comes to heaven, all of heaven throws a party. Come on. And we're throwing a party with you. But every person, Father, I thank you for every person watching here today. Whatever they're going through, whatever they're facing, Father, we speak hope into their situation. We speak joy into their heart, Lord God. And right now in this moment, as we worship one more time, Father, we give you our whole heart. We give you our everything, Father, as we close out here today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Come on, let's worship together. One more time, church.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me in his love. For me, oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed his grace. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died. Chosen by you, yeah, and I am chosen.
Come on, what a powerful word from Pastor Brandon.
That was amazing. Wasn't that amazing? So amazing.
When failure comes knocking, God shouts the loudest. Come on, what a reminder that God is still for you, that God still believes in you and his promises. Nothing can stop the promises from God. I'm fired up, can tell. Hey, if you said that prayer with us and you gave your life to Jesus today, what you can do right now is text Jesus to the number below and let us know that you made that decision. We don't want you to walk this faith journey alone. We want to connect with you and give you resources and just walk alongside of you in your spiritual journey. Also, we have a team, we have our prayer team standing by right now, waiting for you, waiting to connect with you. All you have to do is text prayer to the number below and you will receive a phone call. And we want to pray with you. We want to believe God with you. Come on, don't do this alone. And don't forget, you can text home right now and take your next steps. If you're looking for a church to call home, hey, we would love to get to know you more. Man, how powerful was that message
so
today?
So powerful.
Hey, this was a good Sunday.
Yeah.
You have an amazing Sunday, and we will see you next week. We love you guys.
Love you guys.